Call to order this meeting of the Santa Barbara City Council, Wednesday, May 29th. We'll do our Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Call the roll, please, Ms. Clerk.
Councilmember Dominguez?
Here.
Councilmember Rouse?
Here.
Councilmember Sneddon?
Here.
Mayor Protem Friedman?
Here.
Councilmember Harmon?
Here.
Councilmember Gutierrez?
Here.
Mayor Murillo?
Here. Thank you. Is there public comment items not on the agenda? Are you here not on the agenda, ma'am?
It's the public works budget. Is that...
Then you are the agenda. So you'll wait until we open public comment later. Thanks. Thanks so much. So we'll close open public comment and go to our first item. Ms. Clerk, will you read item two?
Item number two, subject fiscal year 2020 recommended operating and capital budget.
Mr. Casey, will you start us off?
I will. Good afternoon, Madam Mayor and Council members. I am pinch hitting today for Rebecca Bjork, Public Works Director, who is testifying right now at a trial. She hopes to be back later this afternoon, but I will do the initial presentation in her stead and then turn it over to the managers of the Public Works Department, who will take you through what is generally one of your more thorough and dense budget work sessions. Public Works is a very large department. There's a lot of stuff to go through. So Michael, if you could fast forward.
Mr. Casey, let's agree that we'll go through each section and then we'll take questions from the council. So council, take notes as we go along, and then maybe it'll be a better flow that way.
Yeah, our recommendation is that each section make their presentation. At the end of that section, you ask questions of that section.
Sounds good.
I think that's probably best way to go because there's a lot of slides to get through, and so that would be our recommendation.
Thank you.
Okay. So today, like I said, is going to be provided by the different division managers. And again, right, we would recommend just stopping after each section and kind of digging into that and then moving forward after that. Each section will be covered in the proposed budget. It'll include personnel changes, proposed fee and rate changes, if any, and key initiatives and work efforts. As you know, this is a very large department. We've got about 150 slides. So we're going to do our part to try to get through that as expeditiously as possible and answer your questions as well. With that, we'll begin with the department overview of the entire public works budget. As you can see, the department is comprised of seven operating divisions and administration, and we'll get presentations from each of them today. We have a mission statement for the department. They take it very seriously. The mission statements will provide our community with a sustainable foundation to thrive by delivering quality services and public infrastructure through efficient and fiscally responsible practices. So that lays the framework for everything you will see. And it's our largest department in a number of manners. It's got close to 300 full-time equivalent employees, 17 managers, 34 supervisors, and has 36 performance-based budget programs. So with that, I will turn it over to Michael Peace, who is the budget manager for Public Works, and he'll begin the presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Casey. Michael Pease, Public Works Business Manager. Happy to get into our department revenues by fund. As you can see, the total department revenues for proposed fiscal year 20 are $137 million. Our water fund is our largest at $64.3 million, and our general fund is one of our smaller funds at our share of the general fund is $9.3 million. Looking at our expenditures by fund, for purposes of this pie chart, we've included the portions that Public Works receives from the Measure C and General Fund Capital Funds. And again, the total department is $166 million, including those shares. You can see Measure C is $18.6 million in the upper right, and then General Fund Capital is a little less than half a million, our share of that. And again, the Water Fund is one of our largest funds at $71.5 million. Looking at expenditures by category, Public Works, unlike other city departments that have a large share of salary and benefits, Public Works invests a lot of funding into capital, as you can see by the lower left section of the pie chart. $18.6 million is from Measure C, and then our other capital program is almost $33 million. And then again, salary and benefits is one of the pieces of the pie at $43.5 million. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to, we're going to take a slight detour in our roadmap, and I'm going to turn it over to our Water Resources Manager, Joshua Hagmark.
Madam Mayor, Council Members, yeah, we're kind of moving on the fly today. I'm also supposed to testify in this litigation, and I wasn't supposed to do it until tomorrow afternoon, and they've kind of pushed things up. So as soon as I finish up here, I'm heading off there. So
thank you.
Hopefully want to answer all of your questions and take the time that you desire to get through all that. So we're going to start off with the total of water resources here. We have 17 programs, 5 funds, and just over 123 employees. As you saw, our revenues, $87 million between water and wastewater. We make up just less than 2/3 of the entire public works budget. And the projected expenditures for this year are just over $100 million between the two funds. So I oversee the Water Resources Management Group, which includes our water system manager, our water supply manager, and our wastewater manager. I do want to point out that we've recently selected a replacement for our wastewater system manager, who retired in December. So Amanda Flessy will be taking over that role here in June. And she's right here in the audience, yes. You may know her as the Streets Capital manager. So I'm going to dive right in. We'll start with water. We have the Water Resources Management Group, which is the bulk of the budget comes into this program and then flows out. There are 7.5 FTEs in this program, oversees water and wastewater operations, ensures compliance with all our local, state, and federal regulations. We develop short and long-range planning for all of our water and wastewater facilities and assets, and develop and manage water and wastewater fund budgets. The Water Supply Management Group budget for this next year is just shy of $16 million, includes just shy of 10 FTEs, and responsible for the long-term water supply plan, which is going to be a major initiative this year. We will be putting out an RFP for consultant support services to help us with what we believe will be about a 2-year process of updating our long-term water supply plan. We'll be looking for significant stakeholder involvement, and we'll be coming back to you to kind of lay out that whole process, what that looks like. And then, of course, a major component is also the conservation program. We pride ourselves on running a cost-effective, customer-based conservation program, which I think has been incredibly effective during the drought. This is a new program. So DSAL before kind of was embedded in the Water Resources Management Group, and now that the facility is complete and operating, bringing it out into its own program, recognizing it here. The budget, $8.8 million, recognizes both debt service and ongoing contract operation of the facility. It also does have some minor staffing, a small portion of my time, the water system manager, a little bit of the water supply manager. There's a few that will be involved in making sure that this program is operated. And Gibraltar Dam. I actually have a picture of here of Gibraltar spilling this winter, and it kind of, I thought it was helpful to see because it kind of illustrates some of the challenges that we have going on there. You can see how dirty the water is. So we got a lot of silt coming in this winter as a result of the Thomas Fire. And we were fortunate that we kept getting flows, and so it kind of flushed that stuff out of there. But we have lost significant capacity. Prior to this year, we've lost about 20% of the capacity of the reservoir in the last few years. We did submit for FEMA funding for that loss of that, and right now it's looking positive. It's kind of a Hail Mary because the cost to remove the silt projected to be from the Thomas Fire is looking to be about $100 million if you were to physically go in and mechanically remove that silt. It's a big item. And so we're working with them right now at this point. We'll continue to keep you updated as progress, but we've gotten some great support from Carbajal's office, Feinstein's office, and California Office of Emergency Services, who all wrote letters of support for the city getting some financial support with the loss of capacity. The recycled water system, just shy of $1 million, 4.5 employees, and continues to be the kind of the backbone of providing water for our parks and schools. We continue to have a desire to share some of this water with the Kroomba Mutual for their golf course, but until we get that recycled water facility up to its design production, we're kind of limited to just providing the staff for city customers. Water treatment, $5.3 million program, 15.8, and we are asking for a one FTE increase for this year, but it's with an asterisk because the way that we've structured it is that once one of our operator positions is vacant, we will let that go. So there will be there's a one FTE this year, but down the road, once that position is vacated, it will be a neutral increase. And I will be getting into this later in the presentation, exactly what those staffing changes are. So going back real quick, of course, we do oversee operation of the city's surface water, regional surface water treatment plant. So a reminder, you reduce treat water for Montecito and Carpinteria. Compliance with all state and federal regulations. This group also oversees management of our Ortega groundwater treatment plant. And of course, they are responsible for overseeing the operation of our hydroelectric facility at Gibraltar, which we're currently utilizing with the water in Gibraltar. Water distribution, just under $10 million, 32 employees with this program. Again, responsible for a wide range of activities. We have over 300 miles of water mains, 13 reservoirs, 8 pump stations, and 27,000 service connections. Wanting to point out, you know, just day-to-day operations, but this team also provides after-hour emergency services, not only for water, but throughout the city, kind of providing this utility service, trees go down, things like that. We are making some changes I'm going to talk about a little later to really meet the needs of our current workforce. We're, you know, over the years, less and less of our operators live here in town. And so it's difficult to be responsive to those emergency needs. And I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the structural changes we've made to kind of adapt to that. Meter readers, again, this is in many ways a thankless job, but this is our cash registers. These employees are out there making sure we're accounting for every drop that's leaving our system. Absolutely critical. And this team is also working to help with AMI, which is the Advanced Metering Infrastructure Smart Meters, which we're piloting right now. I think a few of you are on our pilot, piloting through 200 of these AMIs, trying to get it comfortable with the technology and understand its challenges, limitations, before moving forward with a full-scale program in 2021. So water revenues, I'm going to highlight a few things. Metered sales, you'll notice that we are projecting a 5% increase. A small percentage of this is actually coming from already approved rate increases. About 3% is coming from a projection of increase in usage. We do as the, we've kind of cut back on our messaging. We are anticipating there will be some increase in usage. We have not seen that yet. We're still seeing strong conservation numbers, but this budget takes into consideration some reasonable rebound. Water service meters, just blanking on this one right now. JPA reimbursement. So we, as I mentioned earlier, we have agreements with Montecito and Carpinteria to treat their water. This right here is just projecting out increased revenues because we have planned work at the treatment plant, and they'll be responsible for reimbursing the city for those costs. Got one more. So here's what you're seeing here is in expenditures. This is really all this amounts to is moving water, the money for desal out of water resources management into the water desal program. So it's really just moving money around. So this is the water capital program for the next 5 years. I'd like to point out just a few things that we've already talked about. So we're continuing with the 2% replacement of our water main program, which is one of our single largest expenditures right now, and I'm really pleased that we're on track to keep pace with that. Right now we're doing two projects a year, so we're breaking it up, making it more attractive to more local contractors. The Cater Plant Program, this is that large project. Familiar with the plant, right in front of the plant is a large reservoir that's underground, about 5 million gallons. It's called the Clearwell, and we're planning to do some upgrades to it to address some structural concerns and water mixing concerns in there. We have $2 million budgeted for recycled water. This is to upgrade the, I think it's the original pump station for the recycled water system, so it's a 1989 vintage pump station, and so it's kind of the backbone of that system, so making in some investments there. And then you'll notice in FY21 under water meter program, you'll see that $4.5 million that's budgeted for AMI implementation. So as I mentioned, the water rates, we have the current proposed rates are going to hit our single family residential customers with about a 1.2% increase. Again, this is below inflation, which is at 3%, but we did this. This is spread the cost out over 3 years and feel this is appropriate. Summer 2019, we'll be kicking off the multi-year rate study, which will, again, look at doing probably another three-year rate adoption, and figure out what we need, and then it'll take into consideration all the information that you just saw there concerning capital. How does our rates compare? For our average customer using approximately 1,000 cubic feet per month, we sit right at just over $120 a month for water service alone. There's a kind of an anomaly on here. The Goleta Water District had a drought surcharge in place that since the drought ended, they had to get rid of the surcharge, but they are scrambling to get their rates back up because they financially can't stay where they are right now. So I'd expect them to be right back up to where the city is. So staffing, since we're in a stage one, we're continuing to staff for the three full-time equivalents, but right now only one of those positions is full. We've transitioned the other positions to an hourly, in that case, if needed, as needed positions. The emergency service worker model, as I'd mentioned, this provides a kind of a backbound response. They respond to all kinds of different emergencies. But what we're moving to is putting those employees on a standby pay. So we've had a difficult time getting people to drive in from Ventura, Oxnard, the San Ynez Valley for these emergencies. And it's unfortunately put an unfair burden on local. Those who do still live local end up being the main responders. So in this case, we're going to have a share of the response, and by that, putting them on this standby pay, which is very common. Wastewater has already done that for a long time, and other departments do that as well. And then with that, we'll take those four emergency service workers that actually currently we only have one. We had a hard time filling. No one was interested in this position, even though it pays more. It's very difficult. You work by yourself after hours, overnight. And so it's basically that one person that we're transitioning to the daytime, but turning all of those positions into something that we can use during the daytime. So that's going to be two new water distribution operators and then a capital program coordinator and an operations program coordinator. And then the new position I talked about was the planner scheduler at Cater. Again, we have one at El Estero, one for the collection system, one for the distribution system, and so it's just bringing Cater up to speed as our last facility with asset management. And eventually, this will be a neutral staff change. We are going to be eliminating an operator down the road once that position is vacant. So, any water fund questions?
Thanks so much. Mr. Friedman, go ahead.
Going back to Gibraltar, I just want to understand the FEMA, a potential FEMA funding. Mm-hmm. Would that be funding to actually do the desilting, or would it be like a mitigation for the loss of it, of the capacity?
Madam Mayor, Councilman Friedman, that is a fantastic question. So where we stand, we have hired, we're struggling with, I'll just say, we've hired a retired FEMA person to kind of help us navigate this because we do not believe it is really the environmental thing to do to actually dredge out the 1,500 acre feet of silt and try and find a location to put this. So we're trying to figure out what the timing is in which we propose an alternative project. And we have a few different alternative projects, but we want to make sure we time that right so that we don't mess up this process. Because unfortunately, we have to go down this road as though we are removing the silt. But I don't think that's in any way where we're thinking we want to go with that. We don't think that's a long-term sustainable solution.
Thanks for the clarification. And then just more of a comment, I guess, but in terms of the Central Coast Water Authority, for the State Water Project, there's, and we've talked about this, there's discussions about the suspended Table A water long-term as a drought buffer. Mm-hmm. So just want to raise the issue as the capacity of Gibraltar lessens, that perhaps that's something that, as we're looking at that again, to kind of tie those two together and see if there is an opportunity. We're going to go down the path as we're exploring the suspended Table A. So I just want to raise that in terms of the larger discussions about diversifying our water supply.
Okay.
Thanks.
Why don't you tell us what Table A water is real quick? I know we have a long afternoon.
It is the water that each of the agencies within the State Water Project has signed up for. So for us, that's 3,300 acre feet a year. That's our Table A that we've signed up for. And what Councilmember Freeman is referring to is when CCWA, so the Central Coast Water Authority, first signed up, we did not take our full allotted allocation. And so they've referred to this as suspended Table A, and there's been a desire by at least the City of Santa Maria and a few others to reacquire that additional water. This item did come to the council, and I apologize, it's probably a year and a half, 2 years ago. And at that time, the council at the time said that we weren't interested in the suspended Table A, but it hasn't moved forward just because I think Santa Maria is struggling to come up with the additional money to purchase that. But we could certainly bring it back for further discussion on that item.
Very good. You good?
Sorry, real quick, Madam Mayor, I did want to, on the water services and meters, I didn't kind of blanked on where that was. This is something where we project out basically buy-in fees. And so it kind of ebbs and flows. And so what we're proposing is basically a status quo. And again, this year's projected is supposed to be low. But again, it really depends on when those projects come through and ultimately when they pay these buy-in fees. So that's what it's an identical one in the wastewater budget when we get to that.
You're explaining that big number, 260?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, thanks. Mr. Dominguez, you're next.
Thank you. I had questions about staffing and something you said earlier in the presentation about having problems keeping people employed. Mm-hmm. Can you elaborate on that a little bit?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Dominguez, always a challenge, especially we've got into a more technical staff, so all of our operators are certified. A lot of times we end up being a nursery. We have a great operator and training program. So we got to the point where we were finding that it was very difficult to recruit people to come here. And so we said, you know what, we're gonna raise our own operators here. And so we've gone through this program of raising these, and for various reasons, you know, sometimes we just don't have vacancies for people to move up, but our neighboring agencies in some ways sometimes pays better because they are separate districts, and so they have a little more autonomy in how they pay, their pay scales. And so we often are losing people. We raise them, we get them well trained, and then a lot of good ones stay. I'm not saying we don't, but we do lose a lot of people, and most recently we just got word today that we lost another one, but this gentleman is moving to San Diego, and he's moving into a supervisor position, which we didn't currently have one. So it's just a challenge. I would consider this kind of in the market of like a teacher, the operators, and so it's difficult to find housing here, affordable housing, and so a lot of them are living outside of the area.
Is this a sign that we have to raise their pay to be competitive?
Well, that's a difficult one. I mean, because typically as a city, we don't compare our salaries to our neighboring water agencies because it would put a lot of pressure on other salaries within the city. But that is a challenge. Those are who we actually compete for labor. But when it comes to comparisons, we're comparing ourselves to Ventura and Santa Maria, Fresno, other areas where I think you can find a little more affordable housing. So so their salary compensation is less.
And in the slide, it says assisting with drought recovery efforts. So why are we continuing the budget for those?
Well, that's a fantastic question. So, yes, our surface water supplies have recovered, but our groundwater basins are at historic lows. And so with that, we are resting our groundwater basins right now. But we're also looking to, as you may recall, we have water debt that we've incurred during the drought. And so we're looking to return water and pay down or pay off that debt as soon as we can. And so with that, we still have some ongoing costs associated with those things.
And if the work is getting more technical and these operators need more skills, is that because there's more automation taking place?
Yeah, I mean, our field crews now all have iPads and are able to, as they go out there, they have, we have an asset management software that allows them, once they do maintenance on that, we're checking off on that, what they observed, observations, and when we need to go back out again. So it's just becoming a much more tech-savvy group, less physical. We still have a very physical component to the job, but it's becoming much more technical.
And is that maybe part of the reason the salaries are being driven up, as you're recruiting people with higher skills, more education, maybe more experience in industry?
Absolutely. I mean, I speak often at UCSB and the City College, and I'm constantly promoting to college graduates a field of operator or operators, whether it's a water wastewater operator. It's a great profession. It can't be outsourced. It's a good living. It's giving back to your community. It is great, and we need that kind of expertise. We need someone who's a little more diversified. It isn't the job that you potentially get out of high school.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Councilmember Sneddon.
Yes, thank you. I'll make this quick. It's I'm always so impressed with all that you manage with the water resources, and thank you. I want to make sure that I understand for G431 and then G445s. So for DSAL, it looks like an additional 8 million use of reserves, but then for capital, then it's 8 million less. Is that what you were saying was moved from one to the other?
Yeah, that's really just moving money around, right? Okay. Right now, in this fiscal year, DSAL is embedded in the Water Resources Management Group, and we're just transferring a one-time transfer out, and then it'll be now ongoing will be a DSAL program.
Yeah. Got it. Thank you. Thank you for explaining that, because that was a question I had from reading it. And then one quick question on G454, just the number of gallons of fog received, and it goes down, mm-hmm. and then stays down. And I was wondering, is that capacity, or that's just what's being delivered from what's being collected? Or why does the number, I just hadn't seen that it goes down from 851 to 775. I mean, it's not significant, but then it stays down at 775. So I was just wondering about that.
Well, that's a good question. And I put that out to staff and haven't heard back from them, but I'll just throw out a few things. It is dependent on, you know, how busy our restaurants are. They're creating the fog material, and the busier they are, the more fog we get. We also, right now, Marburg is the sole collector right now who brings it to the city, but I do know that others bring fog material to Marburg at times, and so depending on where that fog material is originating from, that has an impact. It also, the nearest fog receiving station to us is in Thousand Oaks, Newberry Park. It's called Hill Canyon. They were offline, and I think they're online again. And so that sometimes can shift where the fog material is moving.
And can you remind me what the capacity is? Is it somewhere around 850? If you know offhand, if you don't, it's
I don't. I know the monthly, weekly is 20,000 gallons.
Okay.
So I'd have to... 20 times 52.
Thank you. Yeah. That's close enough. Thank you.
Any other questions for Mr. Hagmark before he has to go?
I got one more.
Oh, okay.
So I'm going to jump to wastewater. Again, I'll move pretty quickly.
We can't forget wastewater.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So we have the lab is in the wastewater program. Again, just serving this essential role in making sure that we're meeting or exceeding all of our requirements for discharge, for drinking water. They also do monitoring for our creeks and for waterfront. So it's a busy group. And again, if anybody wants a tour of a really nice lab, these guys know what they're doing. I'd be happy to invite others down for that. Wastewater collections, you just heard from them on the consent decree. Again, I think what I probably want to highlight here is they're just doing a fantastic job. They've gotten ahead of our sanitary sewer overflows and really made a huge dent, but then now pivoting to deal with those private sewer laterals, which I think you guys are getting a lot of emails about from the public. And so we've now met twice with the Water Commission on revamping that program and really addressing some of the concerns you're hearing from the community. It is our goal to come back to you this summer with an update, and I think we will have a lot of things to get back to you on and on that matter. And I'm happy to answer any questions. The other part to that we're looking at is staffing. So it's a pretty bare bones staff for that. In fact, we've been borrowing a staff person from engineering to help keep the program that we have going, but the number of sewer laterals requiring replacement or some type of work to them is just skyrocketing. And so we're likely to come back with some options to how to better staff that, which I think will help out with that customer service. It's our goal to model the SLIP program after our conservation program, where we get that hands-on, one-on-one communication that I think makes a big difference when you're dealing with something that's this expensive and controversial in some ways. People don't know they own it. We have our El Estero Water Resource Center, under its new name, just under $8 million and just under 23 employees. Again, responsible for protecting public health and the environment. Currently still treating 6 million gallons of wastewater daily. And highlighting, this facility recovers about 80% of its energy. So with wastewater, I want to highlight, this is basically what people pay in their rates, and the 4% coincides, and how to explain it easily, we are proposing a 5% increase in revenue for this year. The reason that it says 4% is it's comparing it to the amended, or the projected versus the amended. But what's projected is a 5% revenue increase. Connection fees, as with water, we are doing status quo here, assuming, development goes up and down. But at this point, we're just assuming what we did last year, even though this year it was a little less than we had projected. And then intergovernmental, we have now this line item in your budget, at least for water, is typically where we have loans coming into, so the state revolving fund loans coming in. And so what's happening here is we are finished up the secondary project, and so we don't anticipate any new revenue coming in that line item. And then wastewater management. This has to do with recognizing the full SRF loan for secondary. So that's coming into that budget. Wastewater collections, this reflects an increase in salary and benefits, and then projected increase in sewer tap activity. And then one more, and then wastewater treatment. Okay, that's pretty minor, unless you want me to get into that. Wastewater capital. The points that I wanted to make here, and you've probably heard from us before, one of our number one projects is the Water Resource Center electrical distribution renewal. It's really critical to allowing us to tap into additional renewable energy. but it's also critical to keeping this facility operating. It's kind of the backbone of what everything operates on, and we're, a lot of this is original equipment. And the challenge is we just recently found out that we are not going to receive SRF funding this year. It's a very competitive process. So just water and wastewater SRF funding are two separate pots of money. And the wastewater side is incredibly competitive. And we were given less points because our project wasn't construction ready. They wanted to see that we were done with final designs. And so because we didn't have final designs, we're only doing preliminary right now, we received less points and others received funding. This is problematic because it really pushes back this project about 2 years. And so we're working internally to try and figure out what other options we have to get this back on track. We have, you know, private financing. The problem with that is the interest rate is significantly more, on the order of about $600,000 to $700,000 more in interest annually. So the SRF is really attractive. And so we're trying to weigh those, but we will be back for more discussion on that and maybe a plan to get that moving again. So the proposed fees this year for services, 3% across the board. And we do have a few things in there. Clarification on reserve capacity charges, just really quick. When people's homes burnt down, we've been waiving those capacity fees, that fixed meter charge that people pay. And what we wanted to do is kind of put a cap to that. So we're setting that at 5 years. This has gone to Finance Committee. And I feel like it's pretty reasonable. Most people are rebuilding their homes and restarting service. But ending that indefinitely kind of has a negative impact on all customers when they're not paying for their capacity in the system. And then we had some minor language edits. And then changes to customer class. We wanted to kind of add some flexibility in here. If people feel like they're in the wrong wastewater classification, that they can come in and request an audit, a review of that. And I think this just helps relieve some concerns some people have. There's some odd situations out there. I think it kind of addresses that. Wastewater rates, right now we're proposing a 5% revenue increase. Again, keeping in mind that inflation's about 3%. So it's a pretty minor increase in revenue, and the rate hearing has been set for June 11th. And this is how our wastewater rates for a single family, average single family residential customer stack up as compared to our neighboring agencies. And with that, I'm here to answer any questions.
Questions? Mr. Dominguez?
Slide 146. What is the intergovernmental? You mentioned it, but I didn't quite follow. So it's disappearing.
Yeah, when we take money in from the SRF loans proceeds, when they come into this intergovernmental account. And so what we're seeing right now is for FY20 is we build out the full loan amount for secondary, and we currently don't have another loan coming in. So it basically drops to zero.
So the $3,319,000, that's principal from a loan. That was a check they wrote us.
Yeah.
As a loan.
Right.
So we just aren't taking out a loan this year.
Correct.
And so why is that intergovernmental? Because it's coming from Sacramento?
Yeah. That's a good way.
Okay. Because I know normally it's when we're doing a service for another agency or vice versa. So, and the source of our repayment of that loan is just the fees we charge customers?
Yes. And that comes out of the wastewater manager expenditures on the next page. That top item there, wastewater manager, that now recognizes that increase there. We were anticipating that, recognizes the full amortization of that loan and the payment that we now have to make.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems like we're satisfied with your presentation. Thanks. And it was nice to visit El Estero. Was that like a month ago,
yeah.
and a half?
Good.
Glad to meet all the employees.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so now that we are done with water resources, Public Works, Michael Pease, Public Works Business Manager, again, kind of getting back on track with our roadmap, I'm going to cover the administration division.
That's Public Works talk, huh? Roadmap.
Yes, our roadmap.
So, administration, okay.
Yes, this is our attempt at a roadmap. All right. So getting into administration. Administration is comprised of myself, the business manager for the department, two analysts, and an administrative supervisor. The analysts provide financial and budget support to the department, and the administrative supervisor helps to standardize administrative protocols and support the administrative staff throughout the department. The program budget is $1.25 million with six FTEs. We are not proposing any changes to those FTEs. We in administration are responsible for monitoring and coordinating the department's budget activities, supporting the administrative personnel and financial management activities of the department, and coordinating a number of citywide and department-wide efforts, including our citywide capital improvement program, coordinating our annual development of our department budget, community outreach efforts, developing department council reports, and timely personnel evaluations. Looking at our expenditures, we're proposing a status quo budget. I do want to point out one correction on this slide. You'll notice that the supplies and services and allocated costs rows, the label on those rows are swapped. So the allocated costs are increasing $6,500 next year, and the supplies and services are increasing $1,400. So I just want to clarify that. But other than that, I do want to point out a couple of things on this slide. Finance updated the salary and benefit forecast, so that reflects that small decrease to reflect turnover and updated staffing. In supplies and services and special projects and non-capital equipment, we're making small allocation changes across multiple line items in those categories. Looking at our revenues, this is a small program. It's again a status quo budget. Do want to point out a couple line items. Our overhead allocation recovery updated when finance updated our citywide cost allocation plan at the beginning of the budget process. And then that also affects our general fund support line item, again, as part of the update from finance with the allocated costs and the salary and benefits and this cost allocation study. Other than that, a status quo budget. Looking at our key initiatives for next year, within the last couple months, we issued an RFP for a project communication specialist. This contract will help us support improved communications as it relates to major projects to the community to make sure they're aware of any major impacts. And we'll be bringing that back as that process continues. Another initiative is coordinating safety training for all new staff within the department. It's a priority for us to make sure they receive the safety training they need as early in their careers as possible. And so in admin, we're helping to coordinate that effort department-wide. Looking at our performance objectives and measures, we had minor changes to our targets, just reflecting updated workload. And then we've added a couple measures program measures to track the time responding to public records requests and complaints received. With that, I'm happy to answer any questions about administration.
Mr. Dominguez.
I have a question about the salaries. The slide 15, and I guess this references G357. The proposed is 972,000. You're showing that as a reduction, even though the projection for this year is 923, that's about a $50,000 increase, so about 5%.
I see your point. Thank you for pointing that out. There is the budget for next year does reflect an updated payroll forecast. I think what was happening on these slides is we have two different kinds of slides. We have a revenue slide and an expenditure slide. And I'm betting that formula in there is reflecting a revenue slide, which is comparing projected against, budget. In this case, it should be reflecting budget to budget. And I believe that comparison is correct, actually. I'm not showing a comparison between projected and proposed, which is what you're talking about. The column with the difference is just comparing amended budget against the proposed budget. Does that make sense?
So it is a $50,000 increase from projected?
Yes. Yes. But I guess my point is that the comparison on the right is just the comparison between amended and budget. But you're saying why did that increase? The increase is we're reflecting savings in this year's budget. due to turnover. We recently had a full turnover of all the staff within the administration division within the last year.
I know you're new.
Yes, I'm new, and a number of our staff are new. And so with that change, the budget was higher because of all the senior staff that were in the division previously. And so now with the turnover, we're reflecting...
Wouldn't the budget drop because you're bringing in new people? Don't they tend to start at lower steps or lower...
And let me clarify. Basically, I'm just explaining why the projected is lower than the amended, which then with the updated forecast in next year, we're a little bit lower than we were in the adopted budget, $980,972. There's also with, you know, group insurance changes, there's a number of benefit changes that happen January 1 of each year. And so there are savings in various line items that reflect why the projection is a little bit lower than what we anticipated. A lot of it is the turnover. And so we also budget for authorized positions. And so when we update the forecast, the number will be a little bit higher than what we see in projected. Does that make sense?
It does. Then the final question related to that is the actual budget for 2018 was $895 for these same six positions. So...
Mr. Casey, you have clarification.
Yeah, Madam Mayor and Councilmember Dominguez. You know, our cost for salaries and benefits go up every year. We give labor increases. Our cost for health benefits goes up every year. I think on average it's 3 to 4% of just salary increases year over year if you hold everything else static. You have a few other pieces moving here that made some adjustments, but I would certainly expect the salaries and benefits line item to increase year over year.
So that's a $77,000 increase in 2 years.
Yeah, on about $1 million, that's about right. That's about 3.5% per year.
But we're talking about 1%, and what did this group get in terms of, and these are just cost to employer. These obviously don't include any extra cost employees picked up, or do they?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Dominguez, it includes salaries. It includes our PERS contributions, which is not included in the 1% that you mentioned. That, as I've mentioned numerous times, has gone up at least 2% a year for the last number of years. It also includes health care increases that the employer is responsible for as well.
Great, thank you.
Okay, very good. I think that concludes the administration division section then.
Yes, Madam Mayor, council members, that's correct. I'm gonna turn it over to our city engineer for the engineering division.
Great, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Pease. Good afternoon, Madam Mayor, members of the City Council. Today I'll be giving just a brief overview of the Engineering Division budget. The presentation will consist of an overview of the Engineering Division and its two programs, highlights of the proposed fiscal year 2020 budget, key changes to revenues, including fees, and a look at some key objectives in the year ahead. The Engineering Division consists of two programs, the Engineering Services Program and the Land Development Engineering Program. The Engineering Services Program consists of four sections, including Water Resources Engineering, Streets Engineering, Airport Engineering, and a Special Projects and Planning section. The Land Development Engineering Program consists of three sections, including Development Review, Real Property, and Construction Inspection. Both programs are budgeted out of the general fund, with the exception of three FTEs in the Engineering Services Program that are funded through Measure A. Over 90% of the general fund expense is budgeted to be reimbursed based on actual activity within these programs. The remaining portion, the 10% of general fund support, recognizes non-reimbursable activity within these programs. The Engineering Services Program is the largest of the two, and the budget is approximately $6.38 million, and that's a correction. I think on your slide that was printed out, it was 5 point something. I noticed that this morning, so just wanted to point that out. The general fund portion of this budget is approximately $5.8 million, of which roughly 90% is budgeted to be reimbursed through charges to various capital programs. There's 36.15 FTEs within this program, which represents a decrease of one half of an FTE. That was a half of an FTE that was shifted into the land development program. So you'll see that on the next slide. This program provides professional engineering and project management services in support of the city's capital programs. While the bulk of our work is internal to public works, supporting water resources and streets, we also manage capital projects at the airport, waterfront, parks and rec, as well as for police and fire. We are involved with projects through the initial development and planning, design, and construction phases, and we're constantly managing the constraints of cost, schedule, and scope while striving to meet the expectations of our project stakeholders. The other program in engineering is the Land Development Engineering Program, a smaller program with a budget of approximately $1.7 million and 9.6 FTEs, which has an increase of the half, picking up from engineering services. The program is responsible for a plan review and inspection of private work within the city's right-of-way. It processes over 1,500 building construction permits annually. That's about six per day. And about 2,000 public works permits through the public works counter. They also manage the outdoor dining and the news racks program. These next two slides look at the expenditures and the revenues of the combined two programs. And one thing I just wanted to highlight here, because it's pretty much a status quo proposed for 2020, is if you look at the projected salaries and benefits, it was showing at the time that we originally put this together a slight salary savings. We've actually ended up having more vacancies than we had anticipated, and we're looking at a projected closer to $6.5 million. So it's going to be a pretty sizable savings on salaries and benefits, and that's going to be significant as we look to the next slide, which is revenues. So again, the proposed is pretty much a status quo, although if you look on the two main line items, engineering work orders, that's projected to be a slight decrease from the amended 2019, whereas the land development fees and charges is proposed to be an increase from what was amended in 2019. And those pretty much cancel each other out, so to speak, and it's close to status quo. However, and we'll talk a little bit more on the next slide about the fees and the revenues, but I did want to point out on this engineering work order line item, if you're looking at the projected versus the amended, it's way below. And just looking at numbers this week, it looks like we're going to be at closer to 4.8. So that's good news that we're trending in a better direction. And then on land development fees and charges, I'm projecting now that we'll be closer to $1.4 million. So the savings that I mentioned on the previous slide combined with these additional revenues, it's looking like the bottom line for the two programs will be in line with what was budgeted for general fund. So I mentioned I would talk a little bit more about revenues. So the engineering work orders were proposing a slight decrease, and that reflects a planned 90% cost recovery for that program. And on land development engineering, it's incorporating results of the fee study, and so we're showing an increase, and that increase is in line with the three-year average of activity that we've had within that program. So regarding fee changes, we're recommending in the land development engineering program full cost recovery with just a few minor exceptions. One is the parking restriction waivers, and the other being address assignment and change letters, pretty minor things. One other item we did want to bring to your attention has to do with the outdoor dining. And just an FYI on that, the way that program works, if you're not familiar, we charge, there's an application fee. So first time into the system, you pay an application fee. And then after that, there's an annual renewal fee that's based on basically what you have out there, number of chairs, furniture, patio heaters, those types of things. So that's considered the rent portion. And with that, we're recovering greater than 100% of the program. The cost to administer the program is probably at about $15,000. And last year, the last full year of data that we have, we collected about $90,000. So that difference, that $75,000, is considered the rent, the fair market value for using that space. So I know it's been talked about, and just wanted to put that out there with some numbers, what it might look like if we went to a fee-based only program where the rent disappeared and we were just charging for the cost to recover our time to administer the program. We anticipate that it would be about $75,000 of lost revenue, the difference between the $90,000 and the $15,000. So I just kind of throw that out there. Can take that to ordinance committee. There would need to be a change if there's some traction on that. I can keep going, or we can discuss that. Keep going. Okay. Just last two slides here. These are objectives, P3s, looking ahead. I mentioned the 90% cost recovery for the engineering services program. So we track that throughout the year, and there's some adjustments we can make if we're trending below that. We try to limit construction change orders. The goal is 5% or less, and we've generally done a really good job with that. And then the other item, I call it project closeout, but there's a lot of things we have to do at the tail end of a project to close it out, filing notices of completions. We do a project completion memo, and then ultimately we archive the project. And we have some P3s and, you know, try to set the bar high so that we are following through. It can be very easy to finish a project and move on to the next one. And having that measure is really important to make sure that we close it out appropriately. Project highlights, all I'm going to say there is you'll hear from the other program managers about various capital programs, and engineering's involved with most of those. For land development engineering, continuing to work with SCE on their downtown reliability project. There's going to be a lot of work in phase three, which is on the Anacapa cross streets between Ortega and Sola, and that's going to pretty much take up the bulk of the year ahead. They're looking at revising practices for survey records and monument preservation. So one of the key things that we are tasked with as a public agency is making sure that survey monuments that are out in the public right-of-way are maintained. That's a public asset and is valuable to the survey community, and it's our responsibility to make sure that they are not destroyed. We track timeliness on plan check reviews. And then the last thing I just wanted to mention is Acela citizen access and launching of online applications. So we're looking at improvements to the Acela interface. We'd like to have a citizen access portal and an ability to do online applications, and that's in the works, but not yet online. That is the end of my presentation. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Councilmember Sneddon has a question.
Thank you. I had two just quick questions. One, what do you do most of your engineering in-house, or is it contracted out, or how much of it is project management and how much is in-house actual engineering?
Yeah. Madam Mayor, Councilmember Sneddon, I would say what we do is project management, and there's probably 10 to 25% that we will do in-house, and a lot more of that is on the streets engineering side than it is on the water resources engineering side, and it fluctuates somewhat with the workload. When there's a lot going on, we have no choice but to hire consultants.
And then is the trend moving toward design build at all, or is it design and then build, or how does that structure generally work?
It's still just the traditional design, bid, build.
Okay. Thank you. And then one other question about the outdoor patio. Where does that $75,000 in extra revenue go now? So what would the loss of that revenue do?
Right. So that revenue right now comes into the land development engineering program as a revenue, and that helps to offset the cost of that land development engineering program. So it would decrease the amount of revenue available to that program.
And would that be debilitating, or would that be doable?
We think partly because there's been so much activity on the land development side in the last 2 or 3 years, it feels like it's something we could absorb. And as things slow down or change, we may have to revisit that. But right now it looks like it would be a negligible impact.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Friedman.
A couple questions. One to follow up on that. If we were to reduce or eliminate that extra fee for the rent, would we think there'd be an increase in number of restaurants or others that are trying to use that space, and thereby a corresponding tax increase? Do we have any estimates of if that would take place? I know we would have a number, but.
Yeah, Madam Mayor, Councilmember Friedman, kind of hard to say. I think we have pretty good participation in that program. We don't have a lot of people who are doing it without the license. But if we were to reduce the fees, there may be more people who would be interested in pursuing that. And that, I think, would be a good thing. It would be something we'd be able to help them with. So hard to say. I don't think it would. It could only increase the numbers, but I don't know how many.
Okay. Yeah. And another question on page 361 of our binder. So it's under the measurable objectives for the year, and I just noticed this on a couple of them, such as file notice of completions within 10 days of acceptance, or achieve projects in a timely manner within 3 months of project notice. The metric is to achieve 100%, but the what we're actually achieving is 10%, 33%, 50%. So I'm just looking at that metric. If the 100% is achievable, what can? Why are we at the 33 or 50% rate, and why are we still going for the 100%? Where it seems like something we could achieve would be a little bit lower, or are there steps we're taking to try to analyze what we've done and how we can improve? And if so, what are they?
Yeah, Madam Mayor, Councilmember Friedman, great question. I think that kind of gets at the heart of P3s and how to develop them and make them be most effective, because these are measures we certainly want to be tracking. They're things that we have to do, and we want to have this incentive behind getting them done in a timely manner. And these timelines that we have put in here, they seem reasonable. It's a pretty small sample size, because this isn't even based on a whole year of data. But it's hard. If we lower that threshold below 100%, then staff may not quite feel the urgency to follow through on those deadlines. So it is kind of tricky. I appreciate that you point those out. I'm not sure what I'd like to. I don't want to make it easier to meet our P3s necessarily, but I also don't like having them show up as 33 and 50%.
I was just wondering, because those caught my eyes. Mm-hmm. Just as so you are looking at what you can do internally in terms of workload and other things to try to raise that number up. And I just wanted to say those ones were just some I noticed, and appreciate you looking into seeing what we can do to increase that.
Mr. Dominguez, your light was on from last time. You have you like to ask questions, so go ahead.
Thank you. The salary picture here looks like salaries went up. So is this the opposite situation of administration, where you didn't replace more experienced people with newer people? And I'm looking at the G361 and land development G365, and I'm not sure, did you aggregate those to get the salaries here on this slide?
Yes, that's okay. Correct.
because on the G365, my notes indicated it went up about 10% from 18 to 2019 and a little bit more to 2020. So a little more than 5%. And then on the engineering services, it went up about $1 million from 2018 to 2019. So little over 20%. So what's the picture that you can paint?
Oops. So you're looking both at G361 for engineering services and then
G365
for land development, and you're looking at the salaries and benefits line.
Yes, and I'd say start with the engineering services with the 361, just because that looks like a more dramatic change. It's $1 million increase out of a $4.5 million salary budget.
Okay, so which columns, just to be sure?
Salaries and benefit row.
Salary benefit row, and then which columns are we comparing?
Actual 2018 and then projected 2019.
All right. Real quick, I think I can get you a couple of answers to that. I think it would take a little bit more digging to piece together the full amount, but we did add some staff with the police station and Measure C coming online. Engineering had some staff added to help deliver those projects, so you're seeing an increase there. And then also just be reminded that this is an actual in that first column, so any vacancies or just turnover, there's always turnover, so that's going to add a little bit more, actually take away from whatever was budgeted that year. And then the proposed assumes that we're fully staffed. It assumes that everybody that we have on board now, if they're due for a merit increase, they get their merit increase, and if there's a 1% or whatever council approves, that is kind of built into the model. So the proposed number is often kind of the highest level that you may achieve. So that's what I think of, at least initially. It's probably not enough to get to the million, but.
Well, I appreciate that. And really, I'm comparing you within your department and then against other departments just to make sure it makes sense to me. In the second and third factor you mentioned, I'm assuming those take place in the other department. So it's really the added staff that must be accounting for most of it. And it's a couple percent, so I can imagine that would be what explains it. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Okay. I don't see any other lights. So we'll move on to the streets division, Mr. DeMore.
Yes.
We're good. Thanks for that on engineering.
Okay, good afternoon, Madam Mayor, Council Members. I'm Jim Dewey, the Streets Operations Infrastructure Manager, and I'll be providing the highlights of our FY20 budget.
Thanks. Good to see you, Mr. Dewey.
Thank you. So the Streets Operations and Infrastructure Management Division is responsible for the design, operation, and maintenance for all the transportation assets in the public right-of-way. So this includes 11 programs, 40 FTE. Derek Bailey, our principal traffic engineer, and I manage the program. And the revenue comes from three funds: the streets fund, which is primarily utility users tax and gas tax; Measure A, which is a half-cent sales tax countywide. And the street sweeping fund is funded with a combination of Measure B funds, Creeks funds, and the street sweeping citations associated with that program. So our budget this year is basically status quo. And the only thing that we're asking is for a reclassification of our administrative assistant to an administrative analyst. So I'll be providing a little bit of the highlights from our operational programs. So Transportation Administration provides the budgeting oversight and support for all the transportation-related sections in Public Works. It also provides for funding for several programs related to streets infrastructure, including the maintenance of street trees, medians, and parkways, and the maintenance of our street lighting systems. This has a budget of $2.02 million and 1.5 FTE. And when I read off the FTE numbers, there's going to be some very slight changes in order to align our FTE better with the programs that they're associated with, but they're not really consequential, so I won't really address them unless you want me to. So roadway maintenance has a budget of $2.16 million and 9.5 full-time employees, and they're responsible for the maintenance of 254 miles of our city streets, primarily for the maintenance of our street pavement systems. They also provide a lot of other services like the repair of potholes, and we manage the roadside vegetation. Sidewalk maintenance program has a budget of $1.02 million and 7.1 FTE. And their primary responsibility is to maintain over 286 miles of sidewalks. They maintain anything that is concrete constructed, so curb, gutter, access ramps, anything like that in the public right-of-way. They're the people that take care of that. We also manage our sidewalk grinding and padding program through sidewalk maintenance. Next, we have storm drain repair and maintenance. We have a budget of $574,000 and a full-time employee is 2.6. And they're responsible for the maintenance of our 99 miles of storm drains that need to be inspected and cleaned every year, and the operation of our Laguna Channel pump system, which keeps the lower downtown area from flooding. During storms, the crew is actively monitoring and clearing storm drain systems during the to minimize flooding. And also our staff is stationed 24/7 at the Laguna pump station to make sure that it's working during critical storm events. We also maintain the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System permit for our storm drain systems. The graffiti abatement program has a budget of $182,000 and 1.1 full-time employees. They respond to over 2,000 calls for graffiti abatement in the public right-of-way and respond to those within 3 working days of receiving the call. They also respond to a number of public vandalism issues to public property and provide noticing for graffiti on private property. The traffic sign and paint program has a budget of $1.1 million and 7.85 full-time employees. Their primary responsibility is to maintain more than 20,000 traffic signs in the public right-of-way and all the curb and pavement markings associated with our streets. The traffic signal program has a budget of $1.9 million and 3.2 full-time employees. And they maintain and operate traffic signals, pedestrian flashers, and radar speed signs. And they also maintain and program all the electronic equipment and maintain the communication networks that tie these systems together. This program also funds all the electrical use for street lights and for traffic signals in our public right-of-way. So that represents a large portion of that cost of the $1.9 million. Traffic engineering has a budget of $782,000 and 4 full-time employees. And they're basically responsible for everything that happens in the public right-of-way, from weighing in on private property development impacts, to setting timing on traffic signals, to redesigning intersections to provide safer pedestrian crossings. Traffic engineering is about the optimization of the city's transportation system to safely meet the traffic demands of all modes of travel. Traffic engineering also responds to many public requests and inquiries about traffic operations. Our next program is Streets Capital. It has a budget of $3.9 million. And Streets Capital is funded by Measure A and SB1, the new portion of the gas tax, as well as by the existing gas tax revenue. It funds part of our overall capital maintenance program for the right-of-way assets and provides grant matches for the large capital projects like bridges. Prior to the passage of Measure C, this would have been the only funding available to fund Streets Capital for everything that we do. So the pavements, the grant matches, and everything. So $3.9 million would not go very far towards that end. And I have a slide that projects our pavement condition index over time. And the red line is where we would be going if not for the passage of Measure C. So we're really grateful for Measure C, and Measure C investment is making a huge impact, not only in pavements, which is represented in by PCI and that green line, but also in all of our other streets infrastructure. Lastly, we have street sweeping. And it has a budget of $1 million and has one full-time employee. So street sweeping is all about keeping the neighborhoods clean and keeping our creeks and oceans free from pollutants and debris. The program covers most of the city and provides more than 17,000 curb miles swept each year. And it's funded through parking enforcement and through funds from Measure B. The residential street sweeping program began as a part of Measure B when it was passed. And a promise was made to the community to provide street sweeping services to residential areas to improve water quality, both in the creeks and in the ocean. Next, we'll be looking at our proposed revenues. And I'm just going to describe the major changes. These three items are really tied into our capital budget. And they look like major decreases overall from our FY 2019 projected to proposed. But in reality, these are funds that are associated with a capital program that will be carried over or will be appropriated in future years for grants. So basically, when FY 2020 rolls forward, monies will roll forward with them, and then we'll appropriate grants throughout the year as we receive them. So you'll see that there won't be that big of a difference between 2019 and 2020 ultimately. Parking violations, I just wanted to point out that our FY19 projected is a little bit lower than the amended budget. This is primarily due to, we had a lot of storm events this year that caused cancellations of the enforcement of the parking associated with street sweeping, and so we didn't collect those revenues. And then in gas tax, I also want to point out, and we have a reduction from our FY19 amended budget to our FY19 projected, and there's a portion of the gas tax called a gas swap. And its purpose is to adjust the gas for inflation, the revenue that we receive for the inflation and the price of gasoline and fuels. And over the last year, gasoline and other fuels have been relatively flat, so we didn't receive $400,000 that was originally projected for that particular gas swap account. So we're a little bit short there. Moving on to expenditures, this appropriated reserve line item, it looks like that we have an increase in appropriated reserves from our amended budget in 2019 to 2020. In reality, when we passed the budget for the approved budget for 2019, we appropriated $100,000, and then we used that money to provide more pavement replacement service. And so the residual was $4,000. So we spent most of that money. So in reality, we're asking for less appropriated reserve in 2020 than we did in 2019. And then this again is associated with the capital program. The capital spending will, you know, we recognize capital spending as we spend it. So some of this money will be carried forward, and then future appropriations will also be spent in FY 2020. So FY 2020 will look very much like FY 19 ultimately as we move forward into it. That $3.9 million is that base funding that we bring in through the streets capital program, net of Measure C. So Measure C really is funds most of what we do now as far as our capital maintenance is concerned. And now I'd like to talk about some of our key capital projects. You've seen this slide before when Ms. Bjork presented before during the capital presentation, and it is all of the funding that we're receiving just for pavement maintenance. So we're investing about $2 million a year in streets capital, and about 13.2 in 2020, and about $11 million in 2021. And as I, again, we're really grateful to have Measure C and this source of funding for our pavements. And we're doing everything that we can to get that money out there spent in a very productive and efficient way. One of our major projects that we're going to roll out this summer is the repaving of Mission Street. So this includes Mission Street from the 101 to State Street, and ultimately also Los Olivos Street in front of the old Mission. And so basically it's to improve safety and to improve ride quality. We're going to be recontouring that street, taking a lot of the crown out of the road. And if you notice, as you drive through some of the cross gutters, sometimes they can be difficult and, you know, hit your bumper. While some of those are going to be smoother, they're still going to, require to have cross gutters. But the whole experience, the driving experience, should be much better. This is going to take a major effort and understanding, a major effort on our part and engineering's part, but also a lot of understanding from the community, because it's going to have a major impact. The cost of this repaving project is going to be $2.5 million, and it also includes realignment of some of the associated intersections to provide a safer pedestrian experience. I also wanted to point out that, you know, this is funded with Measure C and SB1 funds, and all of our projects that are funded with Measure C funds, you can get a lot more detail on our Measure C website. This is a screen capture of the Measure C website. If you want to view this, you can go to our main website, www.santabarbaraca.gov, and just go to the search bar and search for Measure C. Your Measure C link will come up, and you can see all the things that the city's doing, and there's an interactive map there and lots of links and good information about how we're spending Measure C to improve our community. This next project is a project that we're very excited about, and to tell its story, Rob Dayton is going to speak to it.
Madam Mayor, Council Members, the Las Positas MODOC use multipurpose path has been a long time coming. When I first came here to the city in 1991 and saw this project in the 1974 Bicycle Master Plan, I got really excited, but at the same time, after being at the city for about 5 years, thought this will never happen. It's an off-street path So it's not on street like bike lanes. It's a separate path, much like the beachway at Cabrillo Boulevard. And when the active transportation planning grant funding came along, we worked as a team to secure those funds for design. And then lo and behold, we did it again and got it for construction. So we're going to be constructing this at the end of this year. Beginning of next year, and this will go all the way from the roundabout down at Henry's Beach all the way up Las Positas, and then go west along Modoc Road. And then the county has another project that they just got awarded funding to go from there all the way to the Auburn Trail. So this is a transformative landmark project that just, you know, doesn't come along very, very often. It will transform the way the Las Positas moves and recreates, and so we're very excited to see this to fruition in the coming year.
Thank you, Rob. We are currently working on replacing the De La Guerra Bridge. This bridge was built in 1914, and so the bridge replacement will not only renew the bridge, but also will improve the flow for Mission Creek, which is located underneath it. Its location is Mission Creek between Bath and Castillo Streets on De La Guerra, and its total cost for construction is $8.4 million, and it's funded primarily through the Highway Bridge program. This project is designed by our traffic engineering team, and so I'll let Derek Bailey, our principal transportation engineer, talk to it.
Good afternoon. One of the things we do in traffic engineering is we monitor collision trends in the city, and we work to identify ways to make safety improvements to support the city's Vision Zero strategy. Vision Zero, of course, is a policy that serious injuries and fatalities on our city streets are unacceptable. So I want to tell you about a Safe Routes to School crosswalk safety project that we're planning to build this summer. It's at the intersection of Alomar and Puesta del Sol. It's just down the street from Peabody School. And it was the site of a collision involving a crossing guard a few years ago that was helping children get across the street. So there are documented safety issues at this crosswalk. And it's the only crosswalk on Alomar between State Street and Foothill. So it's a long ways to go without a crosswalk. The project will include a new street light, so the crosswalk's well lit when it's dark out, pedestrian activated flashers, curb extensions, and ADA compliant ramps. The project cost is about $218,000. It's funded through federal Highway Safety Improvement Program funds. And it's going to be on your agenda next Tuesday for award of construction. We're hoping to build this summer, so it'll be ready for this fall. In the last 6 years, we've improved 31 crosswalks in the city, almost all of them with outside funding. And what really got that going, and we got really aggressive with our crosswalk improvement program when Sergio Romero was killed on Milpa Street in 2011. So 31 crosswalks in the last 6 years, and we've already secured funding for 37 crosswalks in the next few years. Next summer in 2020, we're planning on applying for grant funding to do more crosswalks on San Andreas Street and on Cliff Drive.
Thank you, Derek. So this map shows all of the pavement maintenance plan for FY 2020. And it includes asphalt surface treatments like slurry seal, cape seal, and microfinishing, as well as asphalt overlays performed by contractors and by our street crews. Our pavement maintenance program is carefully planned to maximize the life of our pavements while providing a balance of work within our districts and between residential and commercial areas. We expect to complete the pavement maintenance of 146 city blocks in 2020. So pretty ambitious program. I provided all the details behind this map in your presentation packet if you really want to get into the exact sections of streets that are going to be treated. This slide shows our road conditions as a percentage in pavement condition index. And it illustrates that it's less expensive to stay up on maintenance than it is to fall behind. Our paving priorities are based upon funding the most efficient way possible, with heavily used arterials and collectors getting the top priority. City streets crews will also be focusing on pavement maintenance in residential areas. So you'll see us out there near your homes. One of our key initiatives this year, as a result of the wet weather that we've had, we've seen a lot of roads degrade from the rain, and a lot of potholes pop up. And we recognize that the roads need not only to be repaved, but also need to be repaired. And so we set up two of our crews, one that does production paving, the same kind of work that the contractors do, and another crew, our asphalt repair crew, that provides deep lift repairs and repairs of potholes. So we anticipate in the next couple of years to really have a focus on repairing and renewing our asphalt pavements. And with that, I'm pleased to answer any questions that you have.
All right, that was jam-packed, that section. So Mr. Rouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mr. Dayton, on the Las Positas MODOC multi-use path, the artist conception there, is that the design that we're going to? In other words, what I'm looking at is we have what I assume over here way on the left is a class one bike lane. But on the main road, we also see a lane each way and middle turn lane, and then also bike lanes. Is that where we're going with that?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Rouse, that's correct. And that's a typical cross section. That's not how it is the whole way, but this is on MODOC right here. We also have bike lanes on both the streets. And the bike lanes are important because, remember, bike lanes have 22 reasons for being. Only two of them are for the bike. So in this case, they provide a recovery for vehicles who are going off the road. So we need that width either way for those roads. Some cyclists are more experienced and they want to be on the street. And then some cyclists are less experienced and they want to be on the bike path. We also anticipate that we probably have other vehicles and pedestrians on the path, as we do find in the Cabrillo Beachway.
Thank you.
Mr. Gutierrez.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Thank you for all the work you're doing. There's actually a crew outside my house repaving the street, so that's exciting. I have a question. I know you said that your department's in charge of basically almost everything that's made out of concrete, but when it comes to the red brick sidewalks on State Street, I've had a few people come to me and ask me whether or not that would withstand an earthquake and whether that'll become more of a hazard than just having concrete if there's just a bunch of loose bricks. So I just wanted to get your opinion about that.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, Councilmember Gutierrez. I don't think that the brick paving is going to matter much if we have a large earthquake. It's fairly easy to repair, so you won't see there may be uplifting and shifting, so I don't see that as a major problem. I certainly don't see it as a danger. Often in the larger earthquakes that we've had in California, there has been a lot of repair that's needed to be done with concrete, and that is really the most costly repairs. So having pavers is probably less cost, but I really don't see that as a safety issue. I'm certain that if we have a large enough earthquake, some of the pavers will shift and will need to be replaced. But again, it would be at a less cost than replacing concrete panels in our typical sidewalk.
Thank you. And to piggyback off of Councilmember Rouse's comment about the bicycle, when exactly is a bicycle boulevard on Chino Street going to be built?
Good
We are doing preliminary engineering on the plan, but I think the allocation's not till 2022. So we're not going to be able to start construction till that time.
Okay, thank you.
Good. Ms. Nem.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. First, thank you for the rapid response to APS got hit so hard this year, and especially this LMR project is really exciting with how many field trips go across there to the Natural History Museum and to Rocky Nook Park and the students that cross there every day. That's a really welcome bit of news there. Which brings me to some questions I have, mostly on page 387, just so I can understand the capital program for streets expenditures goes from 23 million to 2 million after being 11, 36 million, 23, and then down to,
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Sneddon, I addressed that a little bit in my presentation. It all has to do with, we carry our funds from year to year, so a lot of those funds will be carried over into the next year, and then also as we receive grant funds, we'll appropriate those funds in 2020. Those haven't been appropriated yet, so the budget flow will be, some of the money will move forward through carryovers, and then there'll be more money as we receive grants that'll be appropriated. So FY19 is going to look very much like 2020. There won't be that the big variance there.
So I guess my question is, where do we see that in the budget line items? Like, if I want to find that $20 million, is it interspersed throughout? Is it...
The $20 million that's already appropriated this year?
Well, I guess so. So when it says expenditures, it's not that you're actually spending less money on streets. It's that it's just not coming from this line.
It's just a matter of matching cash flows with when they're actually spent. So, some of that that money will move forward. So basically, you've already seen all that money. You appropriated all those funds over the last year. And some of those funds will carry forward into 2020, and then there'll be more grant fund appropriated by you. We'll come before you and ask for funds to be appropriated, and then that'll be recognized in the amended budget for 2020.
Capital's multi-year in nature.
And capital is multi-year in nature, so it's typical for funds to move. Some projects will go 3, 5, 10 years. And okay. So the money will move forward with them.
I think it's maybe something I need a little tutoring from you separately, just where, for me to be able to see where in here when I'm trying to track where that went, but you can help me with that later. I trust it's in there.
I would be glad to.
Okay, thank you. And then is that the same down blocks of city streets that receive asphalt overlay? It goes from 717,000 to projected 84.
What page are you on, Ms. Nim?
Still page G387. Just other program measures, blocks of city streets that receive asphalt.
I can tell that number is orders of magnitude off for some reason.
Okay.
And so I don't have an immediate explanation for that. So it's some sort of error.
Okay, thank you. That's what I was wondering. That was cumulative or okay. And then I just have a question. You said that in the packet there were more details about where some of the overlays were or which streets were being addressed. And I guess if you could just in broad stroke generally talk about, which you did, but maybe a little more detail, on how those priorities are set, which streets get priority, and I know the high traffic ones and those, and I'm so excited about Mission Street, I can't even tell you, but for other streets in, say, high hillside areas that sometimes don't get as much attention, or how are those priorities done, and is it available to the public to see when their particular street will get attention?
Yes. Ultimately, it's our goal to be able to show when streets will get a certain, you know, when streets will be scheduled for maintenance. The problem is that every year those numbers shift. I mean, even this year, when we were putting together our program for the rest of FY 2019, up until last week, we were trading streets in and out, depending on whatever their need was. And what I can say is that we have modeling software that helps us to identify the best opportunities to spend money on different streets. Somebody may ask a question about, you know, why is this street, you know, being overlaid or slurry sealed? Because it doesn't look too bad, whereas my residential street, it doesn't look very good at all. And the answer to that is that we want to keep up on the maintenance of arterials and collectors to make sure that that the pavement that is there has longevity. So along with that, you know, we're identifying every year or every 2 years we go out and we evaluate a zone. Or is it two zones of pavement? Anyway, we every 2 years we're out there looking at a portion of the city and getting new pavement condition index information. And then that feeds into this modeling program that helps us to identify what streets, you know, need to get the treatment. So the bottom line is that, you know, it's a combination of a lot of things. It's science, a little bit of art, and then a little bit of politics, too, because we want to make sure that we spread the wealth across the city. So you could imagine, you know, when we sit down at a table and decide what it is that we're going to do, we have some interesting conversations. And but ultimately, the goal is to spend the money in the most efficient way possible and to make it go as far as possible.
Well, excellent in balancing those three very difficult areas. So thank you. And then I guess I just have a question about how Measure C is reflected. I guess it relates back to my other question, but how it's reflected through this budget. I mean, there's a line item for Measure A sales tax, and it's carried throughout. And Measure C, there's the one slide in the PowerPoint, which really shows that it's a substantial amount of money, and it's benefiting us a great deal. But I'm having a hard time finding it throughout here.
And yeah, I'm sorry about that, because Measure C really is a capital program unto itself. And so most of it was presented at the capital presentation for the city.
Okay.
So it really isn't reflected very well in what I presented today. So I just mentioned it a few times. And so yeah, you would have to refer back to when the capital.
I think that was my missing piece. Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Friedman.
Thank you for the presentation. And I think based on your explanation on Councilman Sneddon's comments on page 379, there was an amount of long line striping repainted, and the budget for this year was $350,000, and it's projected to be at zero, and then $350,000 again next year, or proposed for 2020. So I just want to confirm that the same type of reasoning about the budgets is this case as well.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Friedman, actually that is not an error, and we have a fairly nimble program in that sometimes our priorities change, and so we shift funds and our efforts to other areas. I think I'm going to let Derek Bailey speak to this.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Friedman, in late FY 18, so about a year ago right now, we went through a pretty significant center line striping effort in the city. So overall, our center line stripes are in pretty good condition. So as Mr. Dewey mentioned, that gave us an opportunity this fiscal year to shift funds to other areas that need attention, specifically asphalt and potholes. But we are expecting to get back on track next fiscal year.
Great, thank you. For that explanation. One other for Mr. Dayton, for the Las Positas bike path, is there on the website for the public to get more information on that, or where can we go to inform the public of what it actually is and when the project timelines are taking place? And if you could state the kind of project timelines as well.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Friedman, yes, that's on the Public Works capital map. You can click on that, and it has a press release or some more information on it. And I believe the construction timeline is at the end of this year and the beginning of next, somewhere in there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Mr. Dominguez.
Thank you. So in the Measure C capital program on E14, it has two amounts for pavement maintenance. The $13,250,000 is for 2020. So will that end up being added in?
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Dominguez, yes, that is part of our pavement maintenance program.
And regarding the PCI on G388, it shows actual for 2018 was 61, projected for 2019, 61, and then proposed for 2020 is 60.
That is also correct, because when we went out and did the reassessment for two more pavement zones, we found that there was significant deterioration. And although we had improved a lot of the streets with overlays and other treatments, the overall PCI did fall.
So it's not politically feasible to take those two zones out of the city?
It's politically feasible, I suppose. I haven't attempted that, but
I'm not even going to ask which zones they are. Yeah. It might be mine. That is just disappointing. I know Finance Committee in particular saw the maps and has really followed through the pavement progress and what these numbers mean. So to see it go down, I was hoping you were going to say, oh, that's just a very conservative estimate. We're shooting for 64. And is this partly because of the rains?
It is. It's a lot of it has to do with the rains, and it was just a matter of timing. And you're going to see the PCI advance. But that same program that we used to do our planning produces these numbers, and that's just what came out. So that's.
And Madam Mayor and Council Members, I mean, it's a good line of questioning. It's been our presentation that Measure C is this fabulous boost, but it's going to take a few years for us to really see the fruits of its labors. And so we've really only had kind of one cycle of getting good Measure C money out in the field. And I think as we start hitting more of these zones for the first time, you'll see that PCI moving forward in a much better way.
Okay.
Regarding the potholes and the rain-caused ones, receiving a number of complaints, I know there's a form on our website where people can submit complaints. Is that the best way for community members to check in on potholes?
I wouldn't say that it's the best way. It's one of the ways that we recommend. So they can fill out an online form. They can call up one of our hotlines and ask for service through that. What's important about that is that they need to leave their email address, because we use that in our maintenance management program to respond and to provide updates to the reporting parties. So it's important to get as much specific information about, you know, where the problem is. Leave your name, your phone number, and your email address, ideally.
And are we getting active use in that program?
Yes.
How many people do you think are using that?
I don't have the exact numbers, but almost all of the work that is called in either by phone, left on a message for our hotlines, or sent in through the forms are put into our maintenance management program.
Is this like in the tens or hundreds? I just want to get a ballpark.
Mr. Dewey, there were about 2,000 requests since July 1st last year that are in our system.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Those came in through phone or our online web page.
Okay, so that's a significant number and produces a significant workload, not only fixing the potholes, but corresponding. So that's good to hear that we're using these two methods. Do you know the hotline off the top of your head, either of you, that I could announce here in case anyone's watching?
There's several hotlines, but
we have four more sections left and 40 minutes. So, right.
Okay.
We were going to go to 5 o'clock.
The main street number is 805-564-5454.
5454. Easy to remember. Okay, thanks.
So I have a technical question about transfer out and interfund reimbursements, but maybe I'll wait and just email staff.
These are great questions, yeah, offline as well. Thank you, Mr. Dominguez. So that's good on streets? Okay. So transportation planning?
So I'll continue, but before I do, as Mr. Bailey kind of humbly mentioned that those 31 projects were based on Sergio Romero's death, and I don't want to undermine his death was significant, but that was also the year Derek Bailey came to town. So
that's right.
He is absolutely amazing.
Thank you, Mr.
So transportation planning and parking division is where it all begins to provide the community with a sustainable foundation to thrive, which is our mission statement. And we have two great sections in transportation planning and parking division run by Victor Garza, which is downtown parking, and then Jessica Grant, who runs the transportation planning section. Heather Buck, incidentally, we've positioned her right in the middle to handle all the project management work, and we've actually moved her salary out of the operating budget last year. The council approved that, and now it's all in the capital. So she bills to capital, which is really nice on the operating budget. So first starting in the transportation planning section with three programs, three funds, and nearly five FTEs, we have the here's our budget, almost $1 million, and we do the land development. We're part of the land development team, so we're reviewing parking and on-site parking and access for land development team. And then the transportation planning section also works with the Santa Barbara County Association of Governments. And as you know, Madam Mayor is the representative there, and we work with her and the staff of SBCAG to talk about future vehicle capacity and all the hats that they wear and getting funding. We also do the planning for bikes and for pedestrians, and also the circulation element, making sure that we're implementing that from a project, a policy, council policy standpoint, and then also with land development projects. And then we're implementing the council's Vision Zero strategy, which is something we're highlighting this year. Safe Routes to School is something also we do. And then we also have the Transportation Circulation Committee that advises council. The land development fee changes for this year are from the fee study that was done that was led by community development. And in our area, all the fees that we're proposing deal with outside the process fee. So there's many times, and this happens consistently, applicants want to know how much parking do I have to provide, because that's the basis of a fundamental basis for the design of their project. So they're constantly trying to ask us questions out of process before they even submit. It's a great service we provide, but we're going to start charging for it at the levels that you're seeing here, also for traffic analysis. And then we have the budget for the employee work trip program, and that's for our 900 plus employees for the city of Santa Barbara, getting them to work in various ways that we can reduce traffic. And the one way that we added this last year was the new Amtrak service, commuter service from Ventura. And then also the Easy Lift subsidy is also in this budget, and that's for folks who can't use MTD. So we pay, it's a transit paratransit service. This is the roll-up for those two or those three programs, and these are the proposed expenditures, pretty much status quo. The revenues come in from the LET fees as well as Measure A and utility users, again, pretty status quo. We have some highlights for capital, and we highlighted for you in the last series with streets about that amazing new bike path we're doing in Las Positas Valley. We're also working on other projects we've gotten, the State Street Undercrossing, East Side connectivity for bike connectivity for the East Side, and then also to the West Side. Great projects, the one that's not listed here, that actually Council Member Harmon was asking about this week, is the De La Vina Road Diet from Carrillo to Haley, which will be great. So we're working on all four of those. West Side, we're in the West Side neighborhood right now, doing a West Side Transportation Management Plan. We need to talk and have good conversations with the community if we want to position well for those active transportation planning grants. So that's part of our effort there, is to really hear the community and see what projects there they want to do, because we get big points for working well with the community and then having those projects develop from the community. Vision Zero, working with the police department, with engineering, with Derek Bailey's group, to really see if we can move the needle down on collisions. And you've seen some of those projects. You'll probably see more next year. And then Mission Canyon Bridge Studies, you're all being briefed on that right now. It's just going to be a long process, but it's something that's really important. Moving forward into the downtown parking section with Victor Garza in that lead, four programs, two funds, and then 24.45 FTEs. This budget is actually a reduction in two FTEs. I want to get to that. But we manage 361 days a year, 3,300 parking spaces, five structures, seven lots, two commuter lots. We do the downtown parking committee. We are known in the downtown for our kiosketeers and the service they provide to our community being helpful. And what we've done with those, most people don't know, they know the kiosketeers, but there's also a crew of people who are behind them keeping what represents about 20% of the properties to the right and left of State Street clean and up to date and maintained. And then we also have been trying to bring, in the absence of the redevelopment agency, we've also tried to bring that management of State Street and working with the downtown organization and keeping State Street clean and well-managed, and also managing some of the attractions and people moving device, the MTD contract and incident. And we've just implemented with MTD something we hope will boost the ridership. The ridership has been a sliding, actually pretty steep decline. And so we're doing those day passes with them. It's $1 and you can ride all day long. And we're hoping that that will improve the ridership, because that cost per ride is getting pretty expensive now, up to almost $4 a ride. And then the State Street Ambassadors have been a huge success. These have become the eyes and ears of State Street, so that we see what's wrong before someone has to complain. That's the strategy. And this is a photo at Mini Mart, and she's displaying her certificate that she was awarded for not for carding minors and not serving minors. It's a great team of folks on the street helping out. And then there's many other things that we do in downtown parking. We're handling the curb management. So what color is the curb? What's the regulation of the curb? 90 minutes, 15 minutes, no parking. We're doing that citywide. And then the oversized vehicle ordinance, residential parking permits, downtown monthly parking permits. And then a new program that we're working with PD Police Department on is the crossing guards. It's been very difficult for them to process the crossing guards because of the background checks that they're now required to do. So we have a great process. We're really good with laborers. As you see, we have 24 FTEs, but we have 150, over 150 hourlies that we're managing. So we can manage more, and that's what they are. They're hourlies with the crossing program. We think we could do that more effective. There's a contract coming with the school district that will be coming to you in the next coming weeks. But with all the added things with downtown parking, and particularly the management of State Street and being more of an RDA-like look. Of course, we can't fulfill. We're not have the money for that, but we're trying to kind of manage the cash register, if you will. We are proposing a reorganization that will do that a little bit more strategically. It also is a cost savings of $68,000. It does reduce our FTEs, but what it does is it gives us that in the middle you see right here, a new program, administrative supervisor. So right now we have one supervisor that manages all the labor and the lot, running the lots, and then maintaining the lots is another supervisor. So this will give a programmatic supervisor to run all the other extra things that we're doing, managing State Street, all the programs we're doing. And then also we're coming into an age where we're seeing new technology that we're going to have to really be on the cutting edge of around parking. In the revenue side, we're continuing to see a trend, and this is not new. This is kind of a steady slope of slowly having less people use the parking facilities, mainly for hourly use. And then on the revenue side, or on the proposed expenditures, we're also lowering. So, and that we're working with the downtown parking committee to have a strategic financial plan so that we can account for this and make some adjustments, some of those fee adjustments that we're planning to make up that the continual slope of down on revenues is we're upping the fees for the monthly parking permits. This is commiserate with market. The reason why the Libero garage private level is a steeper increase is because essentially that's reserved parking for a certain amount of people in a lot that is not, the public can't even go into that section. So it's really exclusive. And then also some fees on the lost ticket, because the lost ticket price has gone up. So this is when someone comes and they've lost their ticket. So we essentially charge them for a full day of parking, $20. Annual residential and visitor permits. This is the residential parking program from 30 to 35. That covers our cost. That's not a revenue generator. And then the annual hotel guest permit, which is a grandfathered thing for the Area B down in West Beach, raising that to $100. That's for only 27 permits, exclusive to a certain amount of hotels. And then we do, in downtown parking, spend a portion of the Measure C monies. And so this encapsulates what we've done this last year. And in big brick repair was the thing that we highlighted. The picture shows some brick repair on Carrillo Boulevard, right off State in the zero block. This is Zero East, did a wonderful job honoring the businesses. They did it, we're in and out very quickly, and we're going up and down the street and making sure that we're smoothing out the unevenness. There's 150 trees that, since the plaza was replanted, have been missing. We're replanting those trees. You saw the fountain removals, the two fountains in front of Santa Barbara Inn, curb painting the whole thing, and then the electric boxes, those little green pedestals that people have been charging things in. The new pedestals that we're replacing solely have a locking device, and they're more stable and less likely to break. In downtown parking, capital highlights, we're really being aggressive with new EV charging stations. There's funding for this so we don't have to pay for it. So we'll get the EV charging stations in the facilities. We are finishing up the LED lighting in the remaining garages. That's Libero and the library garages. We've loved to see our meter going down, our electrical bill going down, and then we're looking at solar now over the garages. So we're working with facilities for solar over the Granada garage, which will zero out the library and the offices at the Granada garage. Amtrak building needs it's the railroad depot, is an old building, needs some help with some columns. And then you recently approved a funk zone plan, which we'll be implementing. Online permits no longer need to go to the office. This year, we're hoping we're going to complete that task. And then kind of a new thing for us to be looking at in partnership with community development, this discussion about housing and starting the discussion on Carrillo, coming back to you with objectives with working with the housing authority. And with that, I'd love to answer any of your questions.
Thanks. Do we have some quick questions for Mr. Dayton? Ms. Sneddon, go ahead.
Just really quickly, thank you, Madam Mayor. For the restructuring, when you met with Cosmont and were talking about that, are they aware of the plans for restructuring, or does that come into play? I'm just concerned they may give us recommendations and say have somebody work on those special programs, but you sort of have that in there, and I just wanted to know if the communication has happened.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Stan, you're asking specifically about the land development fees. You're talking about
the restructuring of
right.
the department. Yeah.
No, we haven't talked with them specifically. They met with us and we gave them recommendations about what's going on and the lay of the land. But and we've seen the recommendations at the community meeting. But I'm sure we'll be hearing more and working with them.
Okay. And just in general, that restructuring.
The reorganization?
Reorganization. Thank
it's
you.
It's not related.
Okay. And I think it's helpful to me, because I think downtown parking does so much more than parking, and that really does help delineate, the ambassadors and the other programs, and I think that will be helpful. And then I did have another question. I lost it, though. Sorry. Thank you.
We can come back to you. Are we able to stay after 5 o'clock if we need to, folks? Okay. Mr. Dominguez, go ahead.
Speed round, three quick questions. How many commuters are coming in on the Amtrak at this point? Do you have any up-to-date numbers?
I'm going to look in my email. I might be able to see.
Yeah, it's been going down slightly. I don't remember the last number, so I hesitate to give you a guess, but I can get that for you.
The new EV charging stations, about how many are we going to see?
Madam Mayor, Council Member Dominguez, we are trying to position for the most. So we, with Edison now, we were doing grants with environmental, what's the acronym, Environmental Center?
EDC?
Not EDC, CEC. But Edison now, can, if we do them in 10 space blocks, we'll fund them. So we're looking to do it with them, and then we could do 10 at a time. And so we're hoping to get quite a few in with the Edison model. And they come in, and what's nice about them is they connect to the street. There's a lot of issues with the meters on site, on the meters on each facility, and they can pay for all that infrastructure. So it's really nice. We're hoping to do quite a few.
That's great. And then bike boulevards, any updates on any incoming bike boulevards in the next fiscal year?
So that was that east side and west side connectivity. And okay. The three boulevards are the Alisos on the east side, which parallels Milpas, and then coming across with Coda and Haley couplets, and then Sola above the plaza, State Street Plaza, connecting over to the west side, Winchino. We're looking at that and working with the west side neighborhood. So we're in the midst right now of designing and preliminary designing all of those and costing out the actual locations of where diverters would be, and then working with the neighborhoods on those locations and filling them in on where they're going. So that's where we're at. We don't get the allocation till later in 2022.
Thank you.
Mr. Gutierrez.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Thank you for that report. And just sorry again to harp on the red brick, but since they're just on a bed of sand, are they earthquake? Is that earthquake compliant? Because what I'm just paranoid about is that during an earthquake, they'll just become an obstacle for first responders or for people to try to get out of those areas.
Madam Mayor, Councilmember Gutierrez, any surface that is not necessarily earthquake compliant. In other words, when we build roads, we don't really look at is this a earthquake sustainable buildings more so. So if the earth bends or separates, concrete, asphalt, bricks, that force is so strong they all are affected equally. So if bricks are uplifted, the curb's uplifted, the asphalt's uplifted. It's an equal. Is one less structurally sound or another.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay, very good. And thanks to our public commenters out there who have been waiting. We'll keep going. Facilities and energy, Mr. Wiltshire.
Yeah, good afternoon, Mayor and Council members. And just to be clear, it's just myself and then one more division. So we might be okay because Joshua with water went first. So we're...
That's right. We're doing good.
We've got just myself and, yeah, ease the pressure a little. my name is Mike Wiltshire, and I'm going to be presenting on the Facilities and Energy Management budget. Just a quick overview of our division. We're broken down into six programs and 37 FTEs. Each of those programs has a corresponding supervisor. And we serve a lot of different work throughout Public Works, but our core mission is to kind of operate, maintain, and renew our city facilities. Our buildings are one of our biggest resources, and we're tasked with maintaining them and renewing them for the future. Hopping into our revenues, we're really presenting a status quo budget with a couple of variances. So these two variances in our revenue are solely attributed to 2019. We received some one-time energy incentives and grants, and we're not anticipating receiving those energy incentives and grants in FY20 and beyond. So that was sort of a one-time thing for our street lighting projects and our zero net energy report. Looking at our expenditures, again, everything is roughly status quo with one exception, our special projects line item. We're going to be lower on our special projects, and that's really a corresponding to the revenue from energy projects. So we received that FY19 energy incentives and grant money, and we put them to work within 19, and so that expenditure will not exist in 20 and 21 going forward. So we're not anticipating having those incentives and grants to spend on projects. And one of the main projects there was our street lighting project and some other energy efficiency projects. Going into our programs, so building maintenance, this is our largest program within our division at $3.3 million and 17.85 FTEs. We are proposing one additional FTE for this program, and that's a project engineer. This won't have any funding impact. There's no request from the general fund or additional funding. This is going to be solely to support our chargeback work. We do a lot of work that's outside of our purview. We kind of act as a general contractor for other city entities, for enterprise funds to do projects for them because we have the engineers and trades. And so that work has been ramping up over the past years. And so to free up our existing project engineers for our core capital renewal projects, we're bringing on another one to still support the city with this chargeback work. Some of the other things that the building maintenance division does that may kind of be lesser known is they're our trade staff, so they're responding to over 5,000 annual work orders, so that's dozens a day. And so we've got kind of two of each trades, carpenter, plumber, welder, painters, and they're out every day. You see them in City Hall, and they're the ones that when a work order goes in, they're out there and prioritizing it and making the work happen. Another key thing that the building maintenance program looks after is our annex yard operations. So our city annex yard down on Yananali Street, we maintain and operate that yard, and that serves a lot of departments who are dropping off materials. There's hazardous waste drop-off. Parks uses it for storing parks materials, just sort of a utility space for the city and field work. And one of the key functions of the annex yard is we provide sandbags during rain events free to the public, and so we provided that service. It was really critical this year. We had huge turnout, and so we were kind of staying on top of that and at all hours making sure there was sand and sandbags available for the public. Our electronic maintenance program at just over $1 million and 6.35 FTEs. So this program is really tasked with maintaining our communications. So all departments, phone lines, voicemail, over 2,000 telephone lines, they are responsible for maintaining our critical radio infrastructure. So police, fire radio, every handheld radio in the city, every radio inside of a police car, inside of a fire truck. This work group is kind of keeping that operational. We have radio towers and equipment scattered all over the city up at Lacumbra Peak. And so we're kind of making sure that those are available during critical times. And one of the expectations is that they're available in the worst times, so fire and flood and rain, and so it's a really, really tough job to keep those up and operational 100% of the time. And something else that this group is getting into more recently is building security. So we're kind of moving away from the standard lock and key and moving towards more access control. You'll see it in the basement of City Hall now, where card readers and everybody has an ID card, and that controls access. It's a lot safer and more trackable, and instead of handing out keys to contractors, we can now set deadlines on cards and set timelines. It's just kind of a better way to go. So this is the group who manages that program, and we're going to start rolling it out to all the city facilities. Custodial services, this is kind of bread and butter, key functional service of operating facilities. So they tend to work behind the scenes and make sure that our buildings are operational and ready for business every morning. Environmental compliance. This is a one-person show. It's a standalone budget that's funded directly from the general fund, and it mainly looks after supporting hazardous issues in the right of way. So everything from underground fuel tanks to vector control to hazardous spills, and it really is kind of a support for citywide departments who are doing construction and digging, and it's kind of a very, very important role, but a small program. Our capital projects group. So I've broken it into two categories. So historically, we've received roughly $900,000, and that would be without the injection of Measure C money. And so that money has been used to perform kind of our bigger key long-term maintenance type projects, long-term capital, roof replacements, full facility renewals, kind of readying our facilities for the next 10 or 20 years. Historically, we've been really, really strapped with a pretty major maintenance backlog. As of FY19 and going forward, Measure C is going to dramatically help with that. $1 million to $2 million is relatively small in the bucket of Measure C, but it goes a long way in our facilities program. So we can really start tackling our maintenance backlog. And there's economies of scale there. So where we used to just kind of piecemeal and do what we can, now we can do some major projects on like a whole building approach. And so there's economies of scale, and it will really start to reduce our maintenance costs going forward. So it's really a good thing, and we're looking forward to spending those dollars efficiently. Something else to call out is $350,000 of that $990,000 is specifically for ADA transition. So that's to make sure that our buildings and walkways and pathways that we're working towards compliance with the ADA. This is a list of our some capital projects for FY20 and 21. I won't go into huge detail, but these are kind of more of our year-to-year recurring projects, just bread and butter maintenance projects, HVAC, flooring, paint finishes, stuff that we're doing every year on a recurring basis. And with Measure C, like I said, it's kind of really changed the game on the way that we're able to renew our facilities. And so we can kind of get at some of these larger code compliance issues and larger roof replacements and really attack our facilities from a whole building perspective and kind of ready them for the next 20 years. Energy management. So currently this is a very $1.67 million program with 1.5 FTEs. So it's a small program, but increasingly doing a lot more work. So as you're well aware, there's been a lot of movement in the energy field. The energy management program as it is today reviews over all the city's utility bills. Executes energy efficiency and renewable energy projects and supports water and desal energy efforts, and is currently spearheading the strategic energy plan, which we've spoken about a number of times with council, and I'll go into it a little more in detail here. Our strategic energy plan, I want to preface this with our complete strategic energy plan is due back to council in July. So I don't want to go too deep into the details, but the intent here is to give kind of a primer on the anticipated budget requests and funding requests. And so with the strategic energy plan, what we're really doing with that is working to meet our 100% renewable goal by 2030. The areas of focus that are going to get called out by the strategic energy plan are additional energy program staff. So the plan's proposing 3 new FTEs. We're going to chase things like community choice energy. Start really changing the way that we do business energy-wise. Typically, historically, the energy program has only looked at municipal facilities, our own buildings, our own operations. But somewhat analogous to the water conservation program, we're looking to start engaging the community. So since this is a renewable goal for the entire community, the city and the energy program is going to act as a hub for community input, and we're going to be able to provide incentives and whatever we can to engage the community to help meet this renewable goal. funding. And so this is kind of where I want to speak a little bit in generalities, because we are bringing this full proposal back to you in July. But this is to kind of give you an idea of scope and scale. And so to describe the graph we're looking at here, this is funding requirements that our consultant and the city have been working on to meet our 100% renewable goal by 2030. So the bar graph you're looking at in 2019, the orange part represents our investment in the strategic energy plan, the $200,000 that we have currently outlaid to complete this report. In 2020, we're not showing any funding. That's really a timing issue. Like the strategic energy plan is what we're using to inform our decisions and come up with this budget. It just so happens that that's not going to be complete until July. And we do have a draft, and that's where these numbers are coming from. Obviously with this goal, sooner is better. We only have 10 years. Bringing something forward now, taking action sooner is better than waiting, but in respect to the budget process, we have kind of started the proposed funding in 2021. The lower blue line is our existing level of funding. And starting in 21, the lighter blue line would be additional city staff to support this goal and this program. And the orange bar is outsourced costs, so that would be contracted costs, and that would be everything from starting renewable outreach programs to researching and implementing renewable energy offsite. So there's some contract component and some city staff component. The intent for funding this would be to allocate it to the city departments based on their energy usage. So the way that looks is a large portion of our energy usage is enterprise funds. So we kind of assume that maybe 20% of these costs would go to general fund directly, and the additional 80% would be on enterprise funds if we decide to break it down by city energy usage. So the intent there is just to kind of paint a picture and give you an idea of what the scale of costs are. So the full freight amount going forward is kind of ranging from $700,000 to $900,000 a year to implement the energy management program and go forward and chase our goal of 100% renewable. And I put that at the end because there may be some questions.
And Madam Mayor and council members, you have set the goal of being carbon-free by 2030, I forget the actual term, but that's been a council goal. You've implemented an energy master plan. It's coming up with these recommendations. Next week when we do budget balancing, I will be recommending that you do fund kind of the general fund portion of this. As Mr. Wilshire was explaining, the general fund is a relatively small portion when you allocate it based upon energy usage. But I do want you to be prepared for that. Also, we'll gauge your interest next week as to whether you want to fund it for the second half of next fiscal year as opposed to waiting a full fiscal year to begin that staffing ramp up. There's still some time to get the staffing idea in place, but as Mr. Wilshire said, we've got a short time frame to kind of hit that goal, and so there might be opportunities for us to start that up in the middle of the fiscal year if that's what you want us to start budgeting for.
Thanks. So questions for Mr. Wiltshire? Okay, looks like we're good. Thanks, that was inspiring. And we'll move on to fleet management.
Good morning, Madam Mayor, members of council. My name is Sam Harmon. I'm the fleet supervisor for the Fleet Management Division of Public Works. It's an honor to speak to you today. I'm filling in for Gary Horwald, the fleet manager. He had a marriage in the family, and also a daughter graduating from college, so that's why he's not here with us today.
Good news.
Yes, very good news. So in fleet management, we have 15 full-time employees, and we oversee two funds and two programs. Those programs are the fleet maintenance and the fleet replacement programs. Looking at the fleet maintenance program, for FY20, we have a proposed budget of $3.14 million, and with that, we will maintain and repair 478 vehicles within the city's fleet. We will ensure environmental compliance. That'll be on not only the vehicles, but also our fleet management facility, as well as emergency generators and off-road equipment throughout the city. We manage a shared motor pool program, and we maintain and manage the city's fueling infrastructure at five locations throughout the city. Looking at the fleet replacement program, our proposed budget is $3.34 million. And we will be replacing approximately 40 vehicles for FY20. We start off by meeting with the department. We want to look for every opportunity to replace conventional fueled vehicles with alternative fuel vehicles. We'll place the vehicles on order, and once they arrive, we'll start uploading them with the different safety and work equipment that is necessary for the departments to complete their missions both safely and efficiently. We close the loop on the fleet replacement program by collecting all the replaced vehicles and equipment, and we send them off to auction where we recoup some revenues, and that goes back into our fleet replacement fund. Looking at our proposed expenditures, here we're looking at the difference between the FY19 amended budget and the proposed FY20 budget. Starting with salaries and benefits, we see an increase of 5.4%. And all other line items, we see cumulative savings of just north of $600,000. It sounds better than it is. Essentially what happened in FY19, we made a one-time debt payment, and by doing that in FY19 and not, you know, reaccomplishing that in FY20, it shows, a drop in expenditure. So again, it looks better than it really is. But we will be saving some money for FY20. Looking at revenues, here we're comparing the FY19 projected revenues with the FY20 proposed. And as you can see, the total revenues will drop by just north of $411,000. Again, this is related to that anomaly mentioned. Essentially, what we had is we had a diesel fuel tank project that showed completing, and we had some extra money in a holding account. By transfer that money out of the holding account back into the fleet replacement fund where we borrowed that money to accomplish that project, it showed as both an expenditure and a revenue. Looking at the fleet capital program, we call this the fleet replacement program. Again, our budget for FY20 is proposed at $3.34 million. And here we can see where those funds are allocated. $2.1 million towards general fund vehicles, whereas $1.2 will go towards enterprise vehicles. Taking a look at the makeup of the fleet, so we have 478 vehicles and pieces of equipment in the fleet. 179 of them run on alternative fuel, so that makes up our 37%. On the pie chart, you can see the five different forms of alternative fuel that we use, with renewable diesel accounting for the most with 110. Fleet initiatives, this is one we're really excited about. We are trying to really do our part to decrease our carbon footprint. One of the new things that we have is reusable oil filters. So most people, you know, are familiar with oil filters, and we do approximately 1,200 services per year. So you can imagine we accumulate drums of these waste oil filters. So by going to reusable, we put them in ultrasonic cleaner, they clean, and then we reinstall them. So we're able to take a large chunk of that waste and get rid of it. Also, we have the first police interceptor hybrid, so it looks like an Explorer on order. That's due to hit the road in August. And we're really excited about that. What we're looking for is up to 40% fuel savings on that. And the way it achieves that, interestingly, is there's a lot of idle time on police cars due to all the equipment and a lot of the electrical demands. And it has a hybrid battery that allows it to shut the vehicle down so that they can't idle, but yet all their equipment, sirens, lights, all that stuff will continue to operate. So really excited about that. And we talked a little about the electric vehicle. And a charging station. So what we're doing is, in past years, we would buy electric vehicles without having a place to charge them. So then we'd have to buy the charging stations and then have them installed. So there was a real delay on getting those vehicles really into service. So now we're looking at it differently. We're looking for where can we install these charging stations and build this infrastructure so that we can buy more electric vehicles and plug them in. We didn't really look at this prior to the recent, you know, last year or two, because it's only been until recently that the cost of electric vehicles has gone down with both federal and state incentives, as well as technology bringing those costs down. But not only that, it's the charging stations that we can get installed with Edison at a savings, and looking at other state initiatives to bring our costs down on installing these have just recently come to fruition. So we're excited about that. And lastly, the most important thing I think we're doing is we're really focusing on our staff and developing them, and really proud of them. So we have a technical staff of 10. They've amassed 125 certifications just in the last couple of years, and this is our first time in our history that 100% of our technical staff are certified, and they've earned us most recently as early as yesterday the Blue Seal of Excellence for the third year in a row. So really excited about that. And with that, I'd love to turn it over to any questions you may have.
Are there questions for Mr. Harmon? You gave us such a thorough presentation.
Well, I tried to speed through, even though we don't, you know, like to tell people to speed. I'm trying to get us back on track here.
Thank you so much. We're good on that. Is that it then? Because we did water resources already. Ms. Bjork, your staff did a good job informing us. We'll take the public commenters now. Thank you so much for your staying power. Thank you, sir. Bonnie Raisin, go ahead. You go first. You have 3 minutes. Ms. Crawford, you'll be after her. Welcome.
I am overwhelmed with information. I really thought, you know, public works consisted of street sidewalks and maybe painting the white lines. I had no idea of the extent of the department. I am really kind of not prepared to talk about what I was going to talk about, I think mostly it's just a continuation of things like white lines, you know, and pedestrian crossings. And I travel De La Vina Street, so does, I think, half our population every day. And something really needs to be done about the rate of speed on that street. I was wondering how expensive and if it would be doable to put up flashing 35 mile an hour. You know, I've seen them somewhere, I think. Maybe not in Santa Barbara, but they're flashing and they say 35 miles. And if you go over that, they monitor that so that you know how fast you're going. Because the rate of speed on our one-way streets, I love one-way streets, but it's really excessive sometimes. And so I would hope that with the help of the police department, which I don't see really that often downtown, sort of out there visible to the motorist, I was hoping that someone from that department would be here today to give their feedback on some of this, because they are the ones who would hopefully be present to control speed. But I do want to thank the Public Works Department. This was very eye-opening for me, and I now know the extent of their coverage throughout our city, and I'm very grateful for that. I will continue to watch for routes coming up through sidewalks. You know, there are areas I think that could be improved, but it's nice to know that they're willing to be aware of it, and I think that's probably, you know, what we can ask for all the time is just an awareness from the departments about what's going on and then articulating it. And thank you for the website, and thank you for letting me talk, and it was very enlightening, even though overwhelming. Thanks.
Thanks for waiting all this time. Ms. Crawford, come on up. You'll be followed by Daryl Sheck.
I have some handouts for the mayor and council, including one for Mr. Casey, please.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Roseanne Crawford, I'm here this evening on behalf of the MoveOn.org petition, Save the Historic Mission Creek Bridge. Details regarding this beautiful roadmap presentation. Our hope is that Public Works will be addressing the need for maintenance of the Mission Creek Pedestrian Bridge soon. I gave you three handouts. One is the recently recommended recommendation page of the bridge inspection. I took page 3 of 4 for you to just see those recommendations. And two pictures that have been posted and are appearing. They basically are advertising the bridge study's kickoff. This is a scenic and historic area. I question the placement of these signs. It is an eyesore and an irritation to locals who view this as advertising for these bridge studies. It's an embarrassment to have the tourists see such unprofessional signs. There is no information about what is to be done, let alone what is to be done or when it is to be done. Further, if there was a real safety issue, there would be too much liability for the city not to close the bridge entirely off to pedestrian traffic. All of these recommendations were repairs for maintenance, and they have been recommended since 2017 on this pedestrian bridge, as well as the recommendations that go back to 2011 for the roadway repairs as maintenance. Please consider directing the Public Works to take down these draconian signs immediately. I have had no response from Public Works for an email and a message left asking for information about any maintenance on not only the pedestrian bridge, the roadway bridge, as well going back to the recommendations of 2011. Thank you for your consideration.
Thanks so much. Mr. Sheck?
Thank you.
Madam Mayor and Council, Daryl Sheck with SEIU Local 620. Just a few comments. Just regarding retirement cost sharing, I think as the mayor has pointed out before, our tier one employees in the general unit are picking up approximately 30% cost sharing on those retirement costs. So when there's an increase to retirement costs, there's also an increase to our members. So we all share the pain together with regards to CalPERS. With regards to turnover, I noticed there was one presentation where there was turnover of an entire department of six people. That's another savings in retirement costs typically. If there's a new, if there are new employees coming into public service for the first time, the pension formula is significantly decreased for those people coming in. And also, just in terms of turnover, if there are, is lots of turnover and there's funds accumulated or excess funds left over because people have left the city, it'd be interesting to kind of look into that further. Also, just in general, from last, I guess it was 2 weeks ago, with regards to the capital budget presentation. It was a little bit, I'll just say, underwhelming or disappointing, because it was with such a large proportion of funding going to the city capital budget, and the fact that there was only about 15 minutes to go through it, it would be really interesting in the future presentations if that was exhibited a little more fully. So appreciate the opportunity to give you comments and have a great day.
Thank you so much. We'll close public comment, and this is the time for our council to make comments, feedback to our staff on the public works budget. If there's anything that you'd like to say at this point, then I will. Okay, go ahead, Ms. Snedden.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Really excellent and presentation of all of the data, and I have to say I really appreciate this ongoing tab on the left that has all the departments that are reflected here and then each one highlighted, and it really does highlight how much you do and how many you touch every aspect of our lives every day. And thank you for that. Very excited about the strategic energy plan. Thank you, Mr. Casey, for mentioning that when we do our final, that we'll look at that, because I think it's a really high priority to make sure that that is successfully implemented, has the proper outreach, and really really has a good go of it on our aggressive timeline of trying to get that accomplished. And just in general, just thank you for all that you do and how well you do it.
Mr. Casey?
Madam Mayor and council members, if I could just even just a head nod at this point. We threw out the concept about the fee reduction for outdoor dining. I sensed reading your body language that there was support for that. Am I reading you all well that we might want to consider that as part of the budget adjustment next week? So I'm seeing general support. So I'll put that out there next week as well.
Thanks. Go ahead.
One more comment. Thank you. Ms. Crawford, if you want to set up an appointment and we can get an update on some of the issues that are happening with the bridge signage. I realize that's outside of the scope of our bigger picture here, but if we want to set up an appointment and then maybe we can address some of those questions. Thank you.
Ms. Harmon?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. First, I just want to echo Ms. Raisin. I learned so much today myself. I was taking it all in. I really appreciate it. I'm just absolutely, truly amazing, really impressive. And Mr. Casey took the words right out of my mouth here. I'm really excited about us considering the outdoor dining rent reduction, I guess it is. A lot of folks have spoken to me about that in particular, so looking forward to seeing what that looks like, and thank you all again.
Mr. Dominguez?
So I did want to ask the question I had about street sweeping and the budget, if that person is still here. And thank the public comment. Ms. Raisin, you come to a lot of our meetings. You come to a lot of finance committee meetings. It's great to see you here as a representative of the public. And Ms. Crawford, I know you were at our earlier meeting at the beginning of the year, so it's glad to see you're tracking an issue, and hopefully we get you an answer on those signs. So the question on the street sweeping, the interfund reimbursements, what is that under revenues? This is on G391.
Mr. Dominguez, we're making closing remarks now, and I go ahead, ask one question. The time for questions has passed. I mean, you can always send an email to staff.
We have till 5:30, so it's a quick question.
We were scheduled to 5, but I'm saying go ahead and ask your question.
Madam Mayor, Council Member Dominguez, what line item was it again?
It's the first one under revenues on G391, interfund reimbursements. I'm assuming parking violations is the ticket revenue. And what is interfund reimbursement?
Oh, it's the money that we transfer in to pay for the commercial street sweeping program from the streets fund. So street sweeping is a separate fund, and basically it's a transfer from the streets fund into the street sweeping fund just for the commercial portion of the program.
And then transfers out, which is the last line in expenditures?
The transfers out pay for the parking enforcement officers for the police department.
Okay. So my comments are twofold. One, I just want to make sure we do as much proactively as we can with the SLIP program, because I think there's a lot of community concern, and it's a pretty heavy budgetary item for those household budgets as well as for the city. So whatever you can do to really proactively take care of that. And then my second comment is just great overall work from this department. You know, it's been a tough couple years for a lot of the divisions, and this department is really the key to our public's health and safety and just enjoyment of this great city and this great county that we live in. So the work you guys do, from the people out there with shovels and flags to the people with CAD cam and in the office, it's just really the core to our community. So keep up this great work, each and every one of you. Thank you.
Mr. Friedman.
Well, just want to thank staff for all you do. And I'm glad Ms. Raisin, because she's here a lot of times looking at what we're doing, and I learned a lot just like you. Just want to say I am supportive of the outdoor dining fees and looking at that. And then just in general, all the alternative transportation that we're looking at, all the bike paths and the Vision Zero, just great work and continue to do it. And just really appreciative of everything you're doing. My colleagues have said it, so look forward to wrapping this up next week.
Very good. Thank you. And Mr. Wiltshire, I got a chance to meet your division staff this morning. I'm not sure if you're inviting all the council members to have that intimate 7:30 in the morning safety meeting with your group, but it really is nice to understand the plumbers and the carpenters and everybody that just takes care of us so well. And I echo my colleagues that you do so much good work. Thank you. And for the record, I do support staff's signs on the bridge. Ms. Crawford left. Maybe I'll send her a note. If you thought that was the appropriate sign for safety and notification, you have my backing on that. And I'll close my remarks there. And so, Mr. Casey, our next meeting is Wednesday, June 5th, related to budget. But we have a meeting Tuesday, a city council meeting. Go ahead and tell us. What's our calendar?
Yeah, you have a council meeting Tuesday, regular council meeting at 2 p.m., and then you have budget balancing on Wednesday at 6 p.m., 1 week from today.
So an evening meeting.
Correct.
Okay.
And so assuming you get through all that, that is your final direction to staff on putting together a balanced budget, and then we bring that back for final adoption towards the end of June.
And we did save a little time on Friday, June 7th, in case we don't finish up on the 5th.
Just in case. My expectation with the number of moving parts, which I don't think are that many, you'll get through it on June 5th.
Okay. We'll go ahead and close this meeting. Thank you.